Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Liz Krueger. I'm the chair of the Senate Finance Committee, joined by my colleague, the ranker Tumblemara, who the gavel van tower. Today is Wednesday, June 7th. We are having a Finance Committee off the floor, and we have a series of nominees that we will be considering today, only two of which are actually in here in person. So first, we will interview the two nominees that the governor has given us for the state voter authority. And joining us first, already in her hot seat, is Lily Phan, who is being nominated to be the commissioner and chair of the state liquor authority. Good afternoon. And we're going to ask you, as we ask everyone, to give us a little background on yourself and why you believe you are a qualified candidate for this position.
Thank you for the opportunity to appear in front of you today. My name is Lily Phan, and I've been serving as a per diem commissioner at the state liquor authority for the past 5 years. I am very excited about this elevation to become chair of our agency. I've spent a lot of time observing how the agency operates from the sidelines, and I'm very excited for this opportunity to really make a change in our industry. A little bit about myself. I was born in Hong Kong. I came to the United States as a teenager. I finished at college and I finished at law school. I worked at multiple law firms in litigation, and then I worked on the Obama campaign, and after that, I really couldn't go back to a law firm and was offered an opportunity to join the state senate by Senator Squadron during the Patterson time. I served as counsel to the Social Services Committee, and so I have an understanding of how legislation works and how agencies and the legislature should interact with each other and how to have a productive relationship. I did that very briefly because then we lost the majority, and after that I became a producer. We live in New York, so I became a theater producer, and I also started making documentary films. Many of you may have seen the movie about Anthony Weiner, and I was the main executive producer on that. Again, I've been serving in SLA for 5 years, and so I feel like I have some understanding of how the agency works, some of the issues that we're facing, I hope to be able to use my time to make our work more efficient, and that our licensing process more fairly. There's obviously a lot of IPA or alcohol laws that need fixing, and I'm very focused on trying to get all of that cleaned up and easier for every tier of our industry. And that was about it.
Thank you. We weren't laughing at you. I was laughing at Tom's comment when I asked who the ranker for the Government Ops Committee was, and he said, that's me. I think that makes it easier.
Double duty here today.
Okay. So I see Senator Skoufis first, and I saw Senator Comrie, Senator Liu, Senator Hoylman Siegel. But if Senator O'Mara wishes to jump in as the double ranker, he will go so. I see Senator Griffo. Okay, so Senator Skoufis.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Ms. Phan. It's nice to see you again. And there's obviously a lot of interest in the alcohol space among colleagues. And I think a big part of that reason is because there are so many challenges and problems in the space. As you noted, the laws certainly are archaic. The Senate has attempted to try and fix many of them. We've been alone in many of those arguments and debates among the key stakeholders up here, unfortunately. However, you don't develop laws at the SLA, you administer them, and certainly you develop regs and rules. And so I'd love to hear from you about what your plan is, how you envision, as a first question, fixing the enormously long wait time that exists for our restaurants and bars and taverns to get an essential for their business, an essential liquor license. I mean, we are talking, in many cases, I know constituent businesses, over a year they are waiting to get their application reviewed and if everything's in order, approved. Yes, there are temporary permits along the way, but I will note that because the SLA takes so long in reviewing the license, oftentimes that temporary permit needs to be renewed. In fact, I know businesses that have had to renew their temporary permits 4, 5, 6, 7 times. And each time, it's more paper, each time there's a renewal fee. They're paying those renewal fees because the SLA is taking so long. And so, how do you propose to fix this problem?
Thank you, Senator Scoofus. I think there are a couple of things. The first is that our licensing time have actually, over the past 4 months, been going down. That's a good news. The governor last year gave us the $2 million for 30 extra licensing staff. And what has happened with that implementation is that it was a slowdown before it's a pickup, because we had to first get through civil service, then we had to hire people. And we are, you know, and everybody knows, like, you know, staffing is a really countrywide problem. And we have to have people that come out of civil service. We're fighting, you know, with cannabis over the same license staff. And so it's taking us longer than we thought. And, but it was definitely a slowdown before there was a pickup. I mean, literally our office is getting rebuilt to fit more people. We are halfway through that process. We are still bringing people on board. Issues, we're also at the same time losing people. So, you know, it's just, you know, we're trying to manage that.
Is this simply, in your opinion, a human resource problem? Or is there a bureaucratic problem, or there are writing problems? I mean, I've looked at the application to get a license. It's pretty straightforward. It's not rocket science. I think there are 11, 12, 13, 14 questions, and the questions are pretty basic. And so I, as a layperson, wonder, why is it taking so long to review these applications?
The process is actually much more complicated, because even when you submit applications, you have to mail it. Is, you know, you mail it to a mailbox that's in Philadelphia, someone's scanning the application, someone deposits a check, and then eventually all that material travels to our agency, it gets scanned in, it's labor time, and then also the reviewing time. There's a lot of different elements that when our laws were written, I think that a lot of other agencies felt we need to use this hook to do their work. And so we also review this workers' comp, we're reviewing, we're doing a lot of work for other agencies.
What's the backlog right now?
I think we're at, like, maybe 4,200 applications.
4,200. How many do you get through a day?
I don't know. I have not contributed to that information. Look, I am in agreement with you. If I can go and be a Lyon licensed person, I will go and try to look at what is really the holdup. You know, how can we get faster? But right now we're training our staff to get up to speed, and that's what the slowdown is. Again, in the past 4 months, it has been coming down, and I promise you that that's the first thing, is to clear this black block, because a lot of other issues relating to communication and feedback and all of that, it's, if you don't have a license and you're waiting for it, then there is no need for back and forth.
Yeah, thank you. Can you comment?
So term,
sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay. And then, you know, longer term is that we have a computer system that we're really working hard to build. And when that does come online, all of this is supposed to be done just through, you know, then they can actually pay online, and they can submit the applications online, and we can review it all online, and things will be so much smoother. But, you know,
when you expect that to happen?
I would say we are at least 2 years.
2 years?
1 or 2 years.
For IT?
It's hard because, I am not privy to all the information, but I think that as we change the law, then the system needs to change. And as we're changing, you know, as you guys are doing your work all the time, then the computer system is also being asked to change just the infrastructure of it. And so it's, you know.
I understand that. I would ask if confirmed, perhaps you can explore if there are ways to expedite what seems to be an enormous amount of time to get a computer system online. So let me ask you now, moving on, if you can comment on the dynamics that exist in the second tier, the wholesaler tier. In the liquor and wine space in particular, there's in effect a duopoly. Two companies control the vast, vast majority of the space in that industry. And with that comes all of the problems you would expect from a monopoly or duopoly, in that they hold every other actor over the barrel. You know, if there's no competition, if you don't like what's going on at Empire, or you don't like what's going on at Southern Glazer, you have no place else to turn. If you're a restaurant, or a bar, or a retailer, liquor store, anyone in this space. I appreciate the SLA, you know, I don't think it went far enough, I appreciate the SLA move forward with regs that are now being litigated by the wholesalers to cap case cracking fees. Are there other steps that you think the SLA can and should be taking to level the playing field and provide the other stakeholders an opportunity for a fair shake in dealing with these two behemoths?
Thank you for that question. I think this is a very complicated question. I think we are starting to scratch the surface with the split fee, split case fee advisory that we did as an agency. Just so everybody knows what Senator Skoufis is talking about is that you know, sometimes when liquor stores order not a full case, and they are being asked to open the case, then sometimes the wholesaler actually charges them a fee per bottle, which is something that we try to say that our agency said, you know, you have to limit those fees, and that is being litigated right now in court. I mean, I do think that your idea of addressing the delivery fees is worth exploring. I think that right now, because again, it goes back to the history. When these laws were written, the most important thing was promoting temperance. The second thing was public safety. Economic development for all was an idea that was just recently added. And so between public safety and temperance, it was really important at the time to use the second tier to protect the safety of the substance. And so, I think some of the ideas that came out of the report are very strong, that maybe there is a way to include more players in the market, allowing off-premise licensees to also maybe sell to other on-premise is also another creative idea that you have. We can slowly work on leveling the playing field, right? Because there is more and more people involved. And the public health safety, as far as the content of the bottles, I think is less so now than in the 1930s.
I appreciate that.
So, I think that we are in agreement as well. So, thank you.
Can I just give you one more question, Mr. Chair, so we can go around the table?
Yes. Thank you. So there are two nominations for three seats. There's a seat that will continue to be vacant.
Yes.
Do you expect there to be any issues? How do you anticipate handling a vacancy for an extended period of time? Are there going to be any issues or challenges associated with only having two and three seats filled?
That's a great question. We have within our agency discussed that because we were, you know, in the prior setup, we're already planning on another year with just two people. Our meetings are in person every other week. It's not that hard for us to make plans around our personal lives to show up. So I don't really anticipate that to be a problem. I mean, we canceled a meeting in April because I had COVID. And you know, it just couldn't happen, and that's back in the industry. We do plan on coming up with an advisory that would guide our system along in the event that one of us had to recuse ourselves. Because on the licensing side, if you have to recuse, then it's a no, because only one, because, you know, and still that's like, okay, that, you know, that's okay. But on an enforcement matter, if one person cannot vote, the matter actually never closes. So that's an issue that we, as an agency, will deal with in an advisory.
I want to thank you. I'll be supporting your nomination.
Thank you.
And look, you know, we've had some challenging issues we've discussed, and I look forward to working with you. I think you bring a breath of fresh air and certainly a different personality and perspective than your soon-to-be predecessor, whose approach I did not appreciate, as you know. And you have your work cut out for you. We did speak about the need to improve relations between the SLA and the legislature, and I appreciate the commitment that was made to bring on a full-time, exclusive intergov person for the first time at the SLA, and a commitment to work closer with all of our offices in the Senate. So thank you, and I look forward to supporting your nomination.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next is Senator Griffin.
Thank you, Madam Chair. What do you see your role as when you take on? You've been there for 5 years, and I know Commissioner Ford has spoken highly of you. How do you see your role now as the chair?
How do I see my role? Well, the first thing is that we need to clean up the backlog. The second thing is we need to bring on all staff that we have budget to hire. A few other executive vacancies that we need to fill, and I am excited about doing that. There's also I also want to make sure that our agency's morale is improved. I think that just the press has really beat us down. I think COVID enforcement has really beat us down, where we sort of became the big enemy, and I really want to work hard to fix that. I mean, our agency is 112 people. I've been told that we are one of the biggest tax collectors for the state. Our agency really is small and mighty and really special in itself, and I really want our staff to understand that and own that, because we don't have the rents, we don't have enough level of civil service. Sometimes people don't want to stay because there's not enough places to grow. And so we really need people who are dedicated to the leadership and to the staff and to each other and to the cause and to the industry. And so I hope that my presence will continue to build that, and I'm encouraged by the fact that there are actually a few people who retired in the last few years from my agency who actually see this as an exciting opportunity and want to come back. So I'm encouraged by that, Senator.
So when you talk about the morale and changing that, can you also change potentially the attitude? Because the perception of the agency now has become that it's more bureaucratic. You talk about going to Philadelphia. I'm not sure why you chose, why things have to be sent to Philadelphia in order to be sent back to you.
It's a state contract.
But there's an opportunity for you now to change the operations of the agency.
Absolutely.
And are you willing, ready, prepared to do that?
Absolutely. I am so willing to hear about all the operational issues and how things can be smoother and leaner and faster and more efficient and for everybody to be happier. Like, that's really what I want to do.
And there are a number of obviously recommendations that have been made by the that you just received on alcohol beverage control changes. Do you believe that we can find a way to effectively reflect the need to make some of those changes?
Oh yes, please, thank you. Yes, definitely. Our agency plans to do presentations on the report that Senator Skoufis had brought along. I am so grateful for all the content that's in it, because that has everything that has to do with our industry and our laws. And so we're certainly going to make presentations to all Senate staff and, you know, and hopefully on the Assembly side as well, that we can arrange that so that everyone know what we're talking about and how everyone can get involved in the process. Like, ABC law is just, you know, it's unique and it's small and it doesn't get a lot of attention, but really hoping to raise the visibility of our agency in a more positive way.
And you think it's important also, not only to solicit the input from the members of the legislature here, but also from the industry that you regulate. I mean, I don't know that that's done. They give you different perspectives of what the hardships are, what the challenges may be. So have you really undergone an extensive type of interaction with those that you regulate to find out what they believe are problems and challenges that perhaps you could consider for changes that need to be made?
Yeah, well, thank you for the suggestion. In my prior role, I was rolled off from talking to anybody because I had to make my decision based only on the record. In fact, I really was not allowed to talk to anybody. But now the floodgates open, and it would be a really interesting conversation because a lot of them already know me and, you know, understand my personality and, you know, how I operate and how we can all work together to ultimately get the stakeholders more of what they want.
So is it possible, last question, is it possible the two are appearing today? My understanding, there is a third person that is under consideration right now from the governor. Are you aware of that?
I am not aware of that.
Okay. So I don't know if that person could be sent later, maybe not for confirmation, but be put into that. Because your meetings are going to be important if you have the quorum. And I think the more you meet, the better it may be in order to move operations, in order to facilitate and meet some of the demand and overcome the challenges.
No, I definitely do think that the three-person board is better than the two-people board, 100%. And I look forward to the third person joining.
So there are representatives of the governor in the office, so maybe one of them will take that suggestion back. I suggest this will be our last finance committee meeting for nominations this session. At least that's our goal. Let's see, Senator Leroy Comrie.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Senator Scoopers and Senator Grupo asked a lot of questions that I was going to ask him. How long is this state contract with Philadelphia? Do you know when it expires?
I don't know anything about that. I think it's an OGS contract that has to do with like how money gets deposited into the state accounts. It's not our agency specific.
And you said that you think it's going to take 2 years for the computer system to get up to the grade? Is that a guesstimate or is that told by someone?
No, it's an estimate. I mean, they're facing delays.
Okay. And also you talked about the low morale in the office and what you can do to try to improve that. I would hope that part of that is once you look at the assessment that was done through Senator Scoopers' efforts, that we look at adding more personnel to the office to deal with the 4,200 backlog and the fact that we have businesses that wait up to over a year to try to get even an answer of whether or not they can get their license or not. I have a myriad of businesses that have been stuck and can't get their license, or if they get a fine if they have to deal with a penalty, they can't get it resolved. So I hope that we could try to reduce that backlog. But the main question I want to ask, and I want to thank you for service, for taking on this position, is that you can make sure that you come back to, we've been trying for 2 years to have a meeting with the SLA with members to talk about issues. The previous commissioner refused to do those meetings. So I hope that you would commit to meet with us on a regular basis so that we can help to resolve those issues or at least illuminate them so that the business community around the state can at least understand what the pressures are so that they won't be happy, but at least they'll be understanding of what is going on at the SLA.
Thank you, Senator.
Definitely, I'm committed to having meetings. I don't know what happened before. Maybe there was some miscommunication.
There was no miscommunication. You just didn't want to do it.
I'm sorry.
You know, so it did, and so it was very frustrating for us who were trying to, and I think every member around the table can give you horror stories about interactions with the SLA. So I'm glad that you're getting an intergovernmental person. I hope that person will have the right spirit to deal with the backlog. You probably need two or three people in that shop just to deal with everything that's going on.
Yes. And I really want to emphasize that. Like, I'm here and I'm available to all of you. Like, all of you are welcome to call me, because in the end, the applications only do so much. Like, when you usually there is so much color and there's so much behind each application and every story and every business. And so I really encourage people to tell me all of those things so that when we make a decision, we're really, you know, taking it all in. So it's important for us to know about each individual constituent and their concerns and how to help them. Really, I mean, we are here to make sure that the alcohol is flowing safely throughout the state. That's our job.
And we also want to make sure that the businesses that want to locate in New York State have an opportunity to get their business underway. Unfortunately, New York State is one of the five worst states to start a business in, and we need to improve those numbers as well.
Absolutely.
Thank you. We're going to cut this one off.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Comrie. Next was Senator Brad Boylan-Siegel.
Thank you. Good to see you, Ms. Fan. I am particularly pleased by your nomination for a whole host of reasons, one of which you did not mention when you described your background, which is serving on a local community board for many years, which I represent. And I just wanted to thank you for that service, but also understanding how local community boards work, which for those of us who represent parts of the city, the SLA approval regime is really part, a main part of a community board's work,
yes.
You know, one of the main components. I want to ask you a question about that, but secondly, I want to note too that you're familiar with working with difficult senators. After all, you work for Daniel Squadron, so that's what Daniel, you know, he's terrific. So I think the training you received here in the Senate is going to be really instructive to how you interact with us, and I appreciate Senator Skoufis' and Senator Comrie's attention to those points. But back to the question, which is, what did you learn on a community board, and how will that inform you now in your leadership role at the State Liquor Authority?
Oh, thank you, Senator, for that question. My time on the community board was very rewarding. At the time, I was a single person. I didn't really have an agenda in life. I really wanted to understand the issues of the community. I was placed on the business licensing committee and got a chance to learn this area of law. That's how I learned 200 foot. That's how I learned 500 foot. That's how I learned how the process actually works. In a way, what I really learned was how to interpret the law to help business owners, because sometimes if you look at it black or white, like, you're not supposed to get it. You know, when you consider the application and the community outcry, like, often it's easier to just vote no. But I think I developed this skill of mediating between the licensee and the law, and mediating between the licensee and the other people on my panel. And that is a skill that I've carried with me to this day. You know, often on the licensing stuff, I think that people don't get what they want. The definition of our agency is, if you come to our board meeting, there's going to be someone who's not getting what they want. But I think that the experience of the conversation let people feel satisfied that they were heard and that their complaints and their concerns are addressed, and that the license that was ultimately issued, the boundaries around it, is that it worked for both sides. I tried to find that work, and I spent a lot of time convincing people to stay. Don't leave this process. If you walk out on the community board, this is going to be worse for you. And that is something that I care about you now. And on the flip side, if the community board acts out of line, I also against the businesses. But the world is really coming together. I would say the conflict between the community and the business have actually lowered because of COVID.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator John Liu has been waiting.
Yes. Madam Chair.
Sir.
I move the nomination.
No, we're not discussing. Thank you.
I'll move it later.
Okay. Do you actually have a question?
I'll make a comment based on what Senator Holman-Siegel's questions were and your responses. Different parts of the state are going to be different. Even in my district, different parts of the district are going to be different. So, you know, in some cases, you may be looking to help the business get the license. There's going to be situations where the community is not going to want that license to be granted. So just be mindful of that.
Absolutely. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you.
We definitely realize there is the conflict between the wanting more licenses versus oversaturation and the community's concerns.
Thank you. Senator Martins.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Thanks very much for being here. Thanks very much for taking on this role. I was wondering if you could just walk us through how often does the board meet and that process itself? Because with 4,200 cases of backlog, I'm assuming that many of those have already been reviewed or in the process of being reviewed. Again, the mechanics of how we get to a final decision, I think, is important. And I don't know that everyone necessarily understands it or has asked that question. Certainly, I have.
Okay, thank you, Senator, for that question. So there are two pieces to that. The backlog of the 4,200, it goes through our licensing staff. And there is something called the licensing board, which is a staff made. It's basically staff that is deciding. When our board, which is the full board only, there are certain mandates, there are certain types of applications that come to full board. And so majority of those 4,200 is not coming to the board, so to speak. The board meets every other week, and I would say that we have between 20 to 40 licensing matters that are in dispute that comes to the board. And it's a preset determination if there is community outcry, if the 500-foot ruling came out against them, there's no public interest, and it has to come to full board. When it's determined that they need to come to full board, it gets into a different queue. It's another board moves to come to the board.
To your board?
To my board, yes.
And that would be yourself and whatever other commissioners there would be that are constituted in this case, perhaps two, maybe three, depending on what happens going forward. That other board, who constitutes that board?
It's staff.
Well, who appoints those staff?
It's the full board that does a delegation, and we have to actually name them in the delegation.
As chair, is that your responsibility to designate who's on that board? Because ultimately, on the routine cases, they're the ones making those decisions on your behalf, right?
Yes.
So how is that decision made? Who appoints them?
I don't know yet.
Okay, so that was made by somebody.
The chair and the CEO of the agency. And the commissioner on licensing.
How often do they meet?
I don't think there's a meeting. I think it's just called board, but it's not like they're sitting in a room saying yes together. They, they each have their own functions, and they print licenses.
Well, again, it would be helpful, certainly for me, I'm assuming for other people here, to understand who's making that decision, because if we do have a routine application for a license, and it is proposed, and it's more a review of certain criteria, and as Senator Skoufis said earlier, it's rather straightforward, the application, and it's being done at a bureaucratic level, not at the board level, I guess it would be helpful, certainly for me, to know how that's done, who is empowered to make that decision, and how they are held accountable, and how often they're actually making that decision, or whether it's just in their sole discretion to do so, because that'll go a long way towards explaining a 4,200 case backlog, at least in my mind.
I know, Senator, I have some of the same questions, and I will send you the delegation document that says who currently are the staff people that have that licensing board power. Because I've just been an outside commissioner, I haven't been involved in the actual day-to-day of licensing, and so it's something that I have to look into.
And if you can give us an idea, and certainly I'm sure Senator Skoufis, in his capacity as chair of government ops, can actually take a look at it as well, of actually the mechanics, how that's done. Because having a group out there that no one seems to know about, and having that kind of authority, not knowing how they're appointed, but yet they're the gatekeepers for so many of our businesses across the state, certainly in my district, it does raise some concerns for me.
I understand.
Thank you. Thank you. Next up, we have Senator Toby Smith.
Thank you. The questions that, many of the issues that I was going to ask you have been partially answered already. I'm rather troubled by the fact that you're, in a sense, contracting out the application process, particularly out of state to Philadelphia. And I really would hope that you can have save a lot of time in coming with your computer system. You talked about 112 employees, and you also discussed the serving on the community board. Obviously, there's a very major difference in that, as you know, the community board is unofficial, so to speak. And this is quite the, your position would be quite the opposite. How many inspectors of the 112 people do you have to go out to resolve some of the community board's concerns? I mean statewide, obviously not community boards in New York City, but statewide, how many inspectors do you send out to investigate complaints?
I actually don't know exactly. I think we don't have a lot. We have maybe 20 to 30 investigators in our agency, and most of our enforcement is actually community complaint responses to community complaints.
I don't mean to blunt.
No, Senator, do you feel like there is not enough responses to the community's complaints? You know, I think that we do try to respond when there is a phantom complaint about a location. You know, we send a letter, we say, you know, you're under advising that, you know, there is someone complaining about you, and we will, you know, we'll come check, and then we do go check, and then if there are violations, we do file charges. So that is a process that is happening. You know, post-COVID, we're really trying to let everybody operate their businesses. You know, again, it's based on community complaints, it's based on violence, noise, those big ticket items.
How quickly, and my really last question, because I don't want to prolong the hearing, how long do you expect the how do you propose to reduce the backlog? By upgrading your computer system?
I think that once we get our staff in, we will be moving faster because we're still training. We're at a time of training people. Once people know how to do it, they will all be doing it faster. That's one element. And then there is another element of how do we make the process faster, and maybe we really need to work together. I mean, there needs to be some legislative changes about what is required in an application. It's a conversation that I would love to continue to have about how to make this simpler. Again, we're doing a lot of work for other agencies, and so if we can just get rid of all of that, we'll actually be in a much better place.
Because there's a state agency with close proximity to the Capitol, which perennially, every year we hear about our computer system is being upgraded, we have this backlog, and we don't know what to do. It's very close to us right now. And I don't want to see that replicated at the SLA. It's obvious, I'm referring to a large organization, but they have a backlog every year, and we ask those questions at budget hearings, and we always get an answer of, we're working on it. And I really think that you will bring the imaginative leadership that's needed, the innovation that's needed to resolve that, not become one of these agencies
yes.
where it's been going on for 15 or 20 years in this case.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Next, we have Senator Gallivan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon, Ms. Van. Your background is very interesting in both the public and private sector experience, which is a very good thing, I think, to bring into a position with this. Like my colleagues, I have many of the same concerns for things that were already asked. The timeliness of response, the waiting that costs people who have saved up, you know, a lifetime, saved for their lifetime, for their dream of opening a business. And they express a lot of frustration. That's a particular area that probably many of our offices, it's the biggest area where constituent businesses are calling with concerns. My office has been fortunate. We've had a good relationship over the years. And most recently with the CEO, Sharif Kabir, has helped us out on individual cases. But I don't think it should get to that we have to call and talk to a CEO who then helps a constituent when it would seem the system, especially in this day and age of technology, as we look forward, like Senator Stavisky just talked about, a technology and a computer system could do so much of it, and it could be more customer-friendly, and we can help businesses succeed. We have, I really don't know how much the SLA has been involved in this over the years, but if you, during my tenure here, if you look at 10, 12 years ago, New York State did not have a craft brewery business at all. Mm-hmm. And the state really took the lead in helping to build that industry. And they did it, and they helped businesses succeed. Businesses still had to follow rules and regulations, right? The state's obligation to make sure that things are done safely, people are protected, people are treated fairly, we're concerned about the community, I think is a good model that I hope that you could get to. The question that I have, and I go back to your background, can you help me with, I applaud your honesty when you say that. I just think it's great that you're not making up an answer.
And what?
That you say you don't know to a number of questions that have been asked. But how is it that you've been on the SLA board for 5 years and don't know? Yeah. That you're anxious to learn about operational issues.
No, that's a good question.
And so can you help give me that level of comfort that you've been there all this time? Not even say you don't know, and our board is in charge of it, right? And I mean, something so significant in the state.
So the role at the SLA, there are two part-time commissioner roles at the SLA. We're paid per diem. We only get paid for the day that we work. For the past 5 years, I've worked 3 days every other week for the SLA. And in those 2 days, I get the materials, I prepare it, then I talk to council, and then I go to full board and I vote on those matters only. It's a very confined role, and again, I can only review the record, and I vote on the record. I don't write anything. I don't talk to anybody on the outside. I'm not allowed to talk to any of the electeds. I'm not allowed to talk to any of the stakeholders. Certainly not the lawyers, not the licensees, not the applicants, not the contestants. And so former Chairman Bradley and the CEO have really respected those lines, and I am not part of operation. I don't go to senior staff meeting. I don't go to anything.
How does that role differ now?
Now I'm being elevated to chair. I continue to serve as a commissioner on the board, but I'm being elevated to chair, which gives me a full-time role, essentially, to run the agency.
And you can talk to us?
Yes, and I can talk to you. And I plan to do that all the way. There should be no runs. I mean, we should be all working together to help our licensees and industry and keep promoting, you know, the economic development of this area in the U.S.
And you haven't said it in this way, but and that's a commitment you'll make to us.
Absolutely. Yes, I would. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Unardis, I believe, the last on the list.
Thank you. To have you here, and I'll keep this really brief. You know, I think you're getting the sense from all of us that we are concerned about the agency's responsiveness, whether it's on new applications or renewals or responsiveness. find the community concerns, that the e-call adds to that plate of influence. You know, you're in the unfortunate position of being here to kind of fix, clean up a lot of the mess that we think exists with this agency. You know, in responding to community concerns, particularly venues that are a documented history of non-compliance, a documented history of public safety concerns, venues and establishments that are not good business owners and are not good businesses and are actually hurtful and detrimental to the community. It's been my experience that the SLA's process there has been incredibly slow and incredibly cumbersome. Responsive, but it should not take 2+ years to shut down an establishment where people have been murdered because of the malfeasance of the license holder, of the bar owner, right? That should just not be. And so I would hope that as you're tackling all of these other issues in terms of efficiency and caseloads and backlogs and responsiveness, you also think about ways of, while respecting the due process rights of the applicants and the license holders, of being able to figure out ways to improve the process to go after those bad actors, because the only people that suffer in those circumstances are community members. I'm not talking about the people who might be, maybe, you know, you don't like that it's a dive bar instead of a wine bar. I'm talking like the places where it's a real public safety, right? Like, I had a bar in my district where someone was murdered, an underage kid was murdered, and his murderer was being served alcohol and was also underage. Had a video, had a copy of it that he took us 2 years to get a response. And in the meantime, this place keep opening, and keep hosting parties, and keep lodging the law, and we were told it was just a black box of an investigation. So it got resolved, thankfully, for everyone's betterment, but I think it could do a lot better than that. And so I would urge on you, and as you can be successful, take on this new mantle of responsibility to be more on that as well. And likewise, I will be supporting your nomination in committee. Thank you,
Senator. And to close, Senator Romero.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner, for being here. I've heard nothing but good things about you and your work ethic as a commissioner on the board. And I do understand the nature of being a commissioner in the capacity that you have been, because you're part-time, you're unpaid, and there's a big workload. But you know, we've heard from everybody here, there's a bottleneck in this agency. And I don't think it's things being sent to Philadelphia and getting scanned in taking long, because those checks that the applicants send in get cashed very quickly.
Yeah.
And then a month or two later, they get noticed that, yes, here's your file number, your case has been received, and then you hear nothing for months. So, you know, you mentioned you're going to be chairman, you're going to be running the place. But you also mentioned there's a CEO and there's a commissioner of licensing. Who's in charge?
My understanding is the chair is in charge, but we'll find out. The CEO really runs all the policies, and he's overseeing the entire agency, enforcement, licensing, secretary's office, the hearing bureau. We are a really small agency, but we have a lot going on. You know, like Senator Andrew mentioned, that we actually have to run trials within our agency, you know. I would like to think that I can impact some of the decisions about how to move forward as far as improving licensing time, but our Commissioner of Licensing is a very, very experienced person. He's sort of the oracle of our agency. He's been in many different roles, and he...
How long has he been in that role?
In this current role, yes. Only maybe 2 years, but he's been at the agency for, you know, 30-plus years.
Okay.
And he is really good at it. He's training the staff, like, really, really hands-on, and he's working weekends, he's working nights. I mean, you know, we have people at the agency that's working hard and understanding the impact that this is having on the industry. You know, again, we just add a bottleneck and we will keep moving it along. And,
there's only been, really, in my time in the legislature, which has been a long time, Other than the Labor Department and unemployment during COVID, the SLA has been the number one problem agency for me and my staff. And that's just for bars and restaurants. I mean, we've got a lot more important things out there. Small businesses are extremely important, I'm a huge supporter. But for the SLA to be up there, you know, and right now it appears that the Office of Cannabis Management is following in your footsteps and doing the best to underperform the SLA. It's an embarrassment to the state, how this operates. Just on the timeliness of getting these applications out and the temporary licenses, why does the applicant have to pay another fee for a temporary license due to the incompetence of the agency?
I am aware that that issue is problematic. It's a statutory requirement, and so you can change it.
We can change it here in the legislature.
Yes. You can take it out of the statute and say, while they're waiting, towns don't need review of the rules, don't come back every 30 days and don't pay the 128.
Well, it's very offensive to many constituents of mine that have to do that when it's of no fault of their own. So that's something I think Senator Scrupulous, we should certainly work on. And I agree with everything that Senator Scrupulous started out with here in regards to the SLA. But, you know, repaying for a temporary license fee due to the incompetence of the agency, it's just not right. People feel very mistreated.
I understand. I totally understand. But our hands are tied. Often our hands are tied. You know, that's why the application process, like, we really should work together and try to figure out how to make this more moving and faster for everybody involved.
And I don't know if I can interject that we were supportive of fixing this in the budget, but some others were not.
Okay. We'll continue to work on that. All right. I'm done. I want to thank you for being here.
I'm
just crossing my fingers and hoping that you're going to be an extremely strong chairman of this agency.
Thank you.
And get this ship righted, please.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Breslin,
yes.
Suddenly popping up. Hello.
Good to see you again. As the senator from Albany, I probably get more calls about licensing and what's going on and waves than any other senator. And your conversations here, only 112 employees and 4,200 backlog is just unacceptable. So I hope that you will continue to work with the people here to keep us up to date so that we can recommend statutory changes or recommend to the third floor of the governor's office an increase in manpower, because it's sad when we deal with young couples opening up a restaurant or a bar or opening up events, and they put all their money in and calculated how long it will take, and it takes longer than that, and they're going without money. And I've seen so many businesses fail from the beginning. And that's unacceptable.
No, thank you, Senator. Nice to see you again.
Yeah.
I am very concerned about that as well. I will give you a little bit of history that our agency used to be more than 800 people. In the 80s, we had 470 people. Now we're a third of that. So there is, yes. So, you know, and back then there were a lot of enforcement, and you know, it was different times, right? But I think just from that perspective, that we could probably go back up to 200 people and be operating better and smoother and bring in more for the state, really, because
we're
doing a lot.
You were able to work for Senator Squatter.
Yes.
So if you want to fix it, hopefully you'll ask for others his division.
Yes, of course. Yes, I would. Yes.
I wish you every success and
thank you.
Thank you,
Senator Breslin. And Lily, thank you so much for being here with us. We're going to ask you to excuse yourself now. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I look forward to working with all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so I know John wanted to make a motion. Do you still want to make a motion?
I would like to, Madam Chair, if that's okay with you, but I screwed up earlier.
Thank you. So I'm going to second the motion.
Second.
Thank you, Senator Stavisky. Do we have any no's? Do we have any without recs?
Without recs.
Without recs, Senator Martins. And do we have correct number of votes we need, Jalen, to move this thing forward? So Ms. Phan will be moving to the floor. Thank you very much, and thank you for our, not technically co-chair, but our chair of investigations and government ops. We are next going to ask the next commissioner to come in, and his name is Edgar Belio. Great, thank you. Yes, please join us for getting the hot seat, so to speak. And for those of us who know, who watch committee meetings, just to understand, please have a seat. We are in the second to last day of session. We are doing an enormous number of bills on the floor and debates on the floor. So members keep having to get up and go back to chambers because we're all doing two things at once at least. So I am Senator Liz Krueger, the chair of the Finance Committee, joined by Senator Tom O'Mara, the ranker on the Finance Committee. And we are going to ask you to give us a little bit about your background and why you think you're a qualified nominee for this position with the SLA.
Sure, Senator.
Thank you.
First I would say that it's an honor to be here to answer questions for you. My name is Edward DeLeon. I was born and raised in New York City in the public housing behind Lincoln Center. My family is originally from Bayamon, Puerto Rico. Professionally, the major jobs that I've had in my life, I was a UPS driver from the 70s into the 80s, a New York City police officer from the 80s into the 90s, and since the 1990s, I've been an attorney in private practice. My practice is criminal defense, family law, employment law, and I've also been a hearing officer for over 20 years. My job as a per diem commissioner at the State Liquor Authority will be to render just and fair decisions, which is something that I've strived to do for 20 years now as a hearing officer for a number of agencies, primarily for the New York State Department of Education, involving cases with special ed kids, the Individuals with Disabilities and Education Act. So with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you. Senator Griffo.
Mr. DeLeon, welcome.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you for your service. Are you aware of any of the challenges that the State Liquor Authority is facing?
I have had the opportunity to read the commission report, so I am aware of some of the things that are being lie ahead for the State Liquor Authority. But my position, as I understand it, as a per diem commissioner for the agency, will be to render decisions. And so in that sense, if I'm asked to do anything else, sure, that's what I have to do. But my focus will be on rendering just and fair decisions, as I'm told on my job.
And I understand that. And you do obviously play a significant role. There's only three commissioners right on the State Liquor Authority. In fact, next question is, you make yourself available because upon confirmation there would only be two of you out of the three seats. So you would be available because if there's only one, then that opportunity to render decisions would be very problematic.
Yeah, I fully understand the commitment, Senator. I've spoken to Commissioner Phan about that, and I am available.
And the other issue, Mr. DeLeon, is there are a lot of operational concerns. Now, you obviously have administrative staff, but the commission not only reviews the applications and makes decisions, but you do have an opportunity when you're in the agency to then evaluate and examine how that agency is functioning. If it's not optimal, I'm hopeful that you will lend your voice along with the chairwoman to ensure that we are providing a better organization and agency to fulfill and meet the needs and challenges that are facing many of these industries and communities. Do you agree with that?
I absolutely agree with that, Senator. Absolutely.
and you'd be willing to engage in that regard to ensure that your voice is heard and that you try to make changes that could, should be made to make the agency run better?
Absolutely, Senator, within my, the confines of my job, but if I'm asked to do it, I'm absolutely willing to do it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
Any other questions? So I just wanted to point out that when I reviewed your resume, I found it very parallel in expertise that I think we do need on the SLA. So you've obviously been an attorney, you've worked with the NYPD, you've worked in many different capacities in law-related issues, but you also seem to have some background in some of the issues related to employment and technology. And I don't know whether you were able to hear some of the other questions, but there seems to be real concerns about whether the SLA can streamline its process so that we can both move applications more quickly when they meet all of our criteria, but also get to the problems more rapidly. Do you think that any of your previous jobs help you think through those kinds of challenges?
And yes, because as a hearing officer under the IDEA, there are strict timelines. Decisions have to be rendered very speedily in those cases, and unfortunately there's been a backlog, primarily in New York City, but just fair and quick decisions, especially in this area, are essential. And so many people are depending on those decisions to move forward on other things that they may have, other plans that they may have regarding their businesses, whatever it is. So I have an understanding of the importance of timeliness, and will strive within my capacity to make those decisions as timely as possible.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you. Other questions from anyone? I see John Liu has his hand up. Senator Liu.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move the nomination.
I just want to make sure I didn't cut anyone off. I think we're good. Senator Liu moves the nomination. Anyone would like to second the nomination? Senator Breslin from Albany, who seem to imply they drink more up here than anywhere else in the state, from a previous city statement.
I can attest to that.
No, I'm sorry. You're right. We're not supposed to motion or do anything until we ask you to excuse yourself. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
For being with us today. Before we continue, thank you.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is teamwork.
Is it not a logic motion? Not
well,
that's,
we didn't want to take your vote until the gentleman left. Okay, so we have now motioned. We have seconded. We're waiting for the door to close. Toby to return to the room.
Do we strike any references to drinking?
Your ruin is accepted. Except for those people watching today. All right, are there any no votes for this nominee? Any without Rex? Senator, okay. Two senators without Rex. Jill, I'm assuming we're good on the vote count?
Yes.
We are, so this nominee is also going to be moving to the floor, so thank you for that. Now, if you look at your vote sheet, you will see there are several other nominees who are not coming before the Finance Committee today. The representative nominated to the MTA board, Dr. Rizzo, actually met with the Transportation and Corporations Committee this morning, and Finance Committee members were welcome to join, and his nomination has moved to Finance. Virtuoso was a nominee for the Niagara Frontier Transportation Authority. I believe his nomination also successfully moved through Transportation and Corporations. Maybe I'll just start with them. Are there anyone who wishes to be a no or without rec in Finance on either of those two nominees that went through Transportation and Corp?
Virtuoso.
Okay, without rec, you said? Without rec on Virtuoso, sir.
I'm without rec on Dr. Rizzo.
Okay, so one without rec on Dr. Rizzo.
Two.
I'm without rec. Three without rec on Dr. Rizzo. and one without rec on, or one with a no, excuse me, on Mr. Virtuoso. Okay, and do we have enough votes, Jalen?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, next we are going to, sounds a little confusing because you see four names, one name twice. And that is because one of the gentlemen, Ben Fata, is being nominated to fill a remainder of a slot on a board and then to have a full term when that time is up. So technically, it's really one person for one seat on a board. And then there are two other candidates for that board, Michelle Melvin and Lydia Tang. That board is the Roosevelt Island Operating Corporation. It is actually a part of my district. It is an island between Queens and Manhattan that is technically set up like Battery Park City as its own independent operating corporation that has a board of trustees. These are non-paying positions. Is there anyone who would wish to vote no or without rec on any of these candidates?
Without rec on all of them.
Without rec on all of them.
Without rec on all of them.
Without rec on all of them and without rec on all of them. Thank you. You're all welcome to come visit Roosevelt Island. It's a very unique little island. They like to call themselves the island off the mainland, Manhattan being the mainland. Do we have enough votes? We do have enough votes to move them to the floor. So they also moved to the floor. So we have now completed our assignment at this finance committee for the nominees that were before us and other committees. I think this will be the last finance committee for this session, but you never know. So I always leave open the possibility we might be coming back. We of course know we have some judiciary nominees, but that does not go through the finance committee. That goes through the judiciary committee. So with that, I'm going to close this meeting. Thank you all for your attendance.